In this episode, we talk about civil engineering from a civil engineer, what it really is, what they expect in the major, and the five disciplines of the field. What's up, everyone? This is Jake Voorhees, and you're watching episode 25 of the 1% Engineer Show. Get job hunting focused 1% engineers with my new ebook, The Top 10 Job Hunting Tips for Engineers. Comment below if you want a free copy, and I'll email you the PDF. And if this is your first time on the channel, make sure you hit that subscribe button, guys, so you can be a 1% engineer and crush it in your career. And that rise begins by choosing the right major. I see a lot of engineers asking to define the differences between civil and mechanical and electrical, and some of that is clear to a lot of you, but many students just coming out of high school or they're in undeclared engineering in university, they're not really sure what certain pathways are going to be like. They don't know if civil engineering is for them or one of these other engineering. There's so many. Civil, mechanical, computer, aerospace, you have electrical, you have biomedical. There's so many different types. And since I'm a civil engineer, I can speak directly to this and talk about what it means to be a civil engineer in school, what to expect from the classes, what are the five branches of civil engineering, so you can get excited about potential jobs in this field because it's very wide. You can do a lot of different cool things. I already did a video about finding your engineering passion, so if you haven't seen that yet, check that out in the top right. Okay, here we go. Civil engineering deals with the design, construction, and maintenance of man-made and naturally built environments. That's important to remember. It's not just buildings and bridges, guys. Civil engineers can also work in the natural environment as well, because you have environmental, you have coastal, you have geotechnical, which is a mixed discipline, but you may not even deal with man-made infrastructure within civil, so remember that. And while we're touching on this point, I really do want to emphasize how broad civil engineering is in terms of the five disciplines. That's the point of this video. You could have a room of civil engineers, and I can speak to this, but if you have a bridge person and a transportation person and an environmental science person, coastal person, all in the same room, they may not even know what the other engineers are talking about because their expertise has gone down this narrow road, which is good. And if you're specifically a coastal engineer, say you've worked in that for 10 years, you don't know anything about highways, you don't need to know anything about bridges. And likewise, say you are a geotechnical engineer and you deal with soil foundations or retaining walls, you certainly don't need to know anything about coastlines. You may not need to know anything about bridges. You could have peripheral knowledge, but it really is this open slate where you can combine and fuse disciplines or go as niche as possible, like what I've done within ITS and transportation and therefore traffic. It's really my chain reaction of things: civil, transportation, traffic, and then kind of went into a niche within traffic. It was traffic modeling and forecasting with big data and aerial stuff as well. But that's beyond the point. But it's just an example of how you may be a certain type of civil engineer and you could have 25 or more engineers in one room that all do very different things because of the nature of the industry. It's not like some fields where if you're this, you just work on this one thing. So you have plenty of options, which is pretty good. It's a good situation for civil engineers. So let's kick off the five majors with number one, structural engineering. Of course, we'll start with structural because it is the most stereotypical within civil engineering, potentially the most studied discipline within civil. Structural engineers deal with the design and analysis of structures, which may be buildings, bridges, highway facilities. They could even be offshore oil rigs. They could be underground facilities, but it has to do with a building or some sort of bridge or some sort of dam or some sort of infrastructure element. Structural engineering involves the identification of loads and stresses and strain on these structures, and structural engineers are responsible for running calculations on the materials that are involved and ensuring that this building, this bridge, this tunnel, this dam, whatever it is that your company is working on, that your research team is working on, ensuring that this thing is going to stand up, ensuring that it can deal with the strain, which is pull, which may be found in a bridge environment. But you're always running analysis on the forces that are involved. You see me doing these gestures with my hands because you have weight and then you have force coming off of the ground, just like your basic statics environments. They must design the structure to successfully hold these loads and withstand these stresses so that the building doesn't fall down. The core classes behind structural engineering would be statics, structural analysis, structural design, strength of materials. I specifically took a concrete and a steel bridge design course. You may also be able to take bridge tech electives, which are probably grad student classes later on in your junior and senior year. But since this is one of the core aspects of civil engineering, there's typically many options of courses for you to take, which is pretty exciting. So if you find yourself staring at structures in awe by how bridges actually stand up, and you want to work with the design of overall infrastructure that is beyond a transportation environment, for example, highways aren't always in structural engineering. It's a bridge or a tunnel or a dam that would be structural. So if you find yourself being interested in this, if you find yourself liking statics as a young engineer, then structural engineering is probably a field for you. You can go into bridge, you can go into some sort of niche avenue within it and stand out from other engineers. But this is a very popular, very common field that undergraduates go down is they want to design bridges, they want to design stadiums, they want to design big buildings and other sort of impressive facilities. Two, transportation engineering. Again, that is what I am. I'm a transportation engineer. So you may hear my excitement, you may hear my bias that is maybe somewhat intentionally being provided into this video because I really love what I do. I'm happy to be a transportation engineer. If you go back and watch the Finding Your Passion video, you will understand why it is that I chose transportation engineering. Had something to do with playing SimCity and watching my ant colony and wanting these two things to become fully integrated for the city to sort of wirelessly and in an autonomous fashion, like an ant colony, integrate all the vehicles, all the people, all the buildings and signals, and really be a modern connected city. That's what I dreamed about as a high school student. And I wrote papers about this to get into university. I wrote papers about this in university, which led to my interest in autonomous vehicles. So I love transportation. It's been my destiny ever since I was maybe 14 or 15. So there's a lot for you to do in this field. But in a nutshell, what transportation engineers are doing is concerning themselves with the goods movement or people movement within facilities of our world. And that includes moving them around efficiently and safely as well. That's a very big one. Not only do we want people to be able to get to work and freight to arrive to its destination, but we need everything to be safe. We need roads to be safe. We need traffic measures to be safe. We need to make sure that pipelines, which that's a form of freight actually, don't rupture and affect the environment. We need to make sure that cargo planes aren't falling out of the air. So transportation engineers are always concerning themselves with either people or goods moving from point A to point B. And this is a highlight moment where you will see crossover between two fields. For example, myself as a transportation engineer in my new role that I started about 2 months ago, we are highway people and traffic people, and we work heavily with the bridge team because these two go together. When you're designing a new bridge, you cannot possibly design that bridge without transportation engineers in mind who are telling you what the capacity is for that roadway and what the speed is that drivers can actually do based on geometric conditions. And the bridge people will say, oh, well, we require this. And they heavily have to work together. And this leads into the list of niches within transportation engineering. I've kind of already alluded to many, but you have highway design, You have traffic, which does not necessarily mean vehicle traffic. I want to clear that up right now. You could be a traffic engineer and just work with bike traffic, pedestrian traffic. I've heard stories of people getting graduate degrees in traffic who were agricultural people, and all they cared about was livestock traffic through their facilities, which is super interesting. Again, you have freight. You have engineers who just do facilities design for airports and shipyards. You have ITS, intelligent transportation systems, which is where I found myself over the last 5-6 years doing long-term modeling and forecasting. You also have urban planning. So I didn't even mention transit yet. You may see a bus rapid transit or a high-speed rail in California is a pretty cool project. Or the next aspect of transit is Hyperloop technology. I don't know if it's always going to be transit oriented. I saw some video where cars were submerging under the ground, under the highway, and then they would go onto another vehicle, which would be the Hyperloop underground and tunnel. If you guys don't know about the Hyperloop yet, that's what Elon Musk wrote a paper about in, I think, 2013, and now several companies are doing it. They're testing in Vegas, they're testing in Dubai. So that's a cool technology that is transportation engineering. Keep your eyes on that. So just like structural, you have all these little niche branches of engineering disciplines within this sub transportation discipline. So you have all these little paths that you can follow, and you can figure out what you like and figure out what makes you tick and just keep taking classes in that realm. Maybe you want to go to grad school. Maybe you want to get your first job in this realm. But I want to hit on this transportation highlight note one more time. Part of the reason why it's so cool to be a transportation engineer right now is that it's so heavily linked with data. And not all the fields are. I think in structural engineering, it can become quite cookie cutter unless your company is using BRIM, which is building information modeling or bridge information modeling. Unless they're really doing the cutting edge softwares and things like this, then you're probably going to find yourself being pretty cookie cutter. Same thing with geotechnical engineering. I don't know what types of technologies are out that are helping them because I'm not in that field. But what's really exciting about transportation is that every driver has a cell phone in their car, and soon every car will be connected to infrastructure. So it really is an exercise on big data. We know where these people are going. We know the speeds that they are going. So what I really, really love about this is that it's in bed with technology, transportation engineering. And that is what actually opens up this ITS field. And people are using drones to collect data, and people are using cell phone data to forecast things and getting stuff in real time and using camera technology to analyze situations. That's actually how I ended up with all these cameras, is using a camera outside of Wilmington, Delaware to analyze traffic with Dr. Jack Paleo. Shout out to you. But this field is so, so closely linked to tech that you have a bright future as a transportation engineer, in my opinion, unless you find yourself in highway design, which again is pretty cookie cutter because we fully understand super elevations and how to actually design highways to keep people awake and things like this. So make sure when you pick your major as a late high school student, as a undecided engineering major, just make sure that it's linked in with tech, and transportation engineering definitely is. 3, environmental engineering. This is the branch of engineering which is concerned with the application of scientific and engineering principles for the protection of human populations from the effects of adverse environmental factors. It also includes the protection of environments at a micro or local level, or at a macro or global level, from the negative impacts of humans or the environment itself. It also concerns itself with the improvement of overall environmental quality. I'm not going to go on too long about environmental engineering because it's definitely not my forte. I certainly never got too excited about it in undergrad, but here are 5 different areas within environmental engineering that you could get a job in or you could go to grad school in. You may find yourself working in solid waste management, environmental impact assessment, water supply and treatment, wastewater treatment, or air pollution management. As you can see, this is a very water resources epicenter. Environmental engineering utilizes a higher regard for chemistry and biology than other branches. So if you're considering civil and you like biological sciences, then environmental is definitely for you. Okay, moving on. 4, geotechnical engineering. Geotechnical engineers concern themselves with everything beneath the ground level. And they study the rock and soil that supports engineering systems, meaning buildings or highways or bridge pillars or whatever it may be that this soil foundation, this rock foundation is beneath regarding some sort of infrastructure. So therefore, geotechnical engineers work heavily with foundations, retaining walls, tunnels, slope stability. They use the principles of soil mechanics and rock mechanics to investigate subsurface conditions and materials, determine the relevant properties of these materials, evaluate stability of natural slopes and man-made soil deposits, and of course, assess geotechnical risk. And I'll say this about geotechnical engineering, it's definitely the most subjective of the five disciplines. What I mean by that is that it's very, very challenging to know what's going on beneath the soil layers, even when you do soil samples and even when you have plenty of data. You just never know what's going to happen. So some people run from the hills when they hear this, and some people are very attracted to this field when they hear this. So there's always some uncertainties. There's always a bunch of unknowns when you are designing geotechnical systems. So keep that in mind for your future. For example, if you're interested in engineering, you probably can think of several historic events that have led to things like this. Most notably, the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Engineers miscalculated what was going to happen with that soil foundation, and the tower is totally leaning today. I think it's something like 11 degrees or very significant, clearly, because it's famous. Because of that, engineers have done all types of support maintenance, and there's a bunch of underground stuff going on. I don't think they have cables because it makes it ugly, but they definitely have a bunch of counterweights that are going on in order to save that tower, because geotechnical engineers weren't around then or didn't really do their job very well. And on a local note, for you East Coast people, for you Delaware people, everyone knows about what happened to the Indian River Inlet Bridge. They started building the bases, the ramps of the bridge to go up and then cross the inlet with no foundation. So it was going to be a big bridge, but one side settled like 3 extra feet and they had to fire the engineering company. They had to totally do a new design and restart. And the state of Delaware originally sued this company for $19 million. And they inevitably settled for like 5 or 6, but it was a huge blunder. And in some ways, these are the fears, these are the threats, these are the risks of geotechnical engineering in general. Sometimes you just never know what's going to happen. So you have to be willing to take that on as a geotechnical engineer. And last but certainly not least, 5, coastal engineering. Coastal engineering is a study of the processes ongoing at a shoreline or construction within the coastal zone. The field involves aspects of nearshore oceanography, marine geology, and civil engineering, often directed at combating erosion of coasts or providing navigational access. And as I mentioned already, I did research with a coastal engineer who was a camera expert. He used his camera systems to monitor the shoreline, to analyze the risk of scours, which can suck out swimmers into the ocean and be a threat to beachgoers, and other types of marine and scour and bridge and shoreline monitoring in general. Some other examples of coastal engineering include artificial harbor generation, dredging operations, seawall construction, bulkheads, piers, and submerged pipelines. So these are the 5 disciplines of civil engineering, guys. I hope this video helps you understand a little bit more about the field, how diverse it is. It gives you a little bit more ideas of where your career can go so that you can get excited about being a civil engineer if that's what you think is for you, and know that any cool job out there awaits you. Make sure you hit that subscribe button, guys, so you don't miss out on more videos. Thanks for watching the 1% Engineer Show, guys, and stay hungry on your quest to become a 1% engineer. Cheers!